Because we'll talk more about space in particular with our guest Andrei Kushlin, who joins us on the program now.
Good morning.
Andrei.
Hello.
Good morning.
Hello. Welcome.
Hello. Now, very nice to be with you.
You're from the World Bank and you have a particular interest in this because you're supporting a project that focuses on satellite. How can I put this? Satellite scanning technology, basically the viewing of the Earth and what's taking place on it from space using satellites. Why are you interested in this and why do you think this is an important project?
Yeah, this is a project that we're talking about. It's called the Open Landscape Partnership Platform. It sounds like a little bit of a complex name, but it's really about seeing from space using the available space technologies to see what's happening on the ground so that anybody with interest in what's happening in your beloved forest or in your favorite hunting spot or in a nature reserves, which is a habitat for Siberian tigers or any other, you know, important and precious location, can actually watch for it and make sure that things that are happening there are consistent.
You're talking about the good stuff right
yes,
now, but
yes.
It also sounds very much like spying. So basically anyone with access to this program can zoom in and look at someone's backyard?
Well, we are living increasingly in the era of open data.
Yeah.
Actually, that's one main reason for the World Bank to be interested in it. 3 years ago, the World Bank has adopted its own open data policy, which released all data that's generated by the, you know, numerous departments of the World Bank and working in almost 200 countries is mm-hmm. publicly available for anyone to use and analyze. So that's part of what the World Bank has been actually leading this effort among the multilateral institutions to set example to others, and many countries are now following that. So we are interested in that, in the open data aspects of this. And in terms of satellite technology, it is called open spatial data, which is mm-hmm. the data, mm-hmm. geographic data, which again, as you mentioned about spying, yes, of course, 90% of the existing market for satellite imagery is still pretty much paid for by defense applications. These are the so-called
90%.
90, yeah, 90.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's what kind of still continues to drive the technological development. But really, I don't mean just the World Bank, but mm-hmm. our broader goal with our partners and the civil society, the environmental organizations, is to start increasing the use of civilian applications of mm-hmm. such data. Mm-hmm. We are talking of the images which are 2 or even 1 meter resolution at scale. So that's typically where you can see individual cars, you mm-hmm. know, kind of that level imagery.
Who would be interested in using that?
This is Google Earth has made a revolution in making
Earth.
It available to anyone. What they are doing, they're actually buying at a kind of bulk mm-hmm. Prices. The imagery which was already once bought by these defense applications.
All
so
right.
for cities and densely populated areas, you can, you know, if you click on Moscow for that matter or any other large city in the world, you will see all that imagery on Google Earth, which is very high resolution mm-hmm. and you can see those very fine details. If you want to do the same and go look at let's say Lake Baikal, you know, the jewel of Russian nature,
pixels,
you will not find that high level resolution mm-hmm. because it's not available, it has not been purchased through those you know, mass purchases mm-hmm. that Google Earth does, simply because there is not enough interest in it. So mm-hmm. our joint objective with companies like Skanex, who is leading this program from Russia, really mm-hmm. cutting edge research and development center, and also their NGO called Transparent World. Mm-hmm. It's also a Russian organization based in Moscow. So they are leading the pack in starting to make that data available for free to the to the civil society so that they can start using it to monitor the objects that they care about.
For
free.
Internet yeah. users.
Internet users, yes. Mm-hmm. So this data also comes from, right now it's the level of detail of such data is still only available on commercial terms, but Skanex wanting to break the mold of this being really driven by commercial applications mm-hmm. or defense applications is making a donation of that data. 2 million square kilometers of data they are donating to this project, to the Open Landscape Partnership Platform, which will be made available to all non-commercial scientific research.
Very generous. It'll be interesting to see how it's used. Just to understand, we're talking about here, we have like snapshots, like photographs, as opposed to like live streaming?
No, not live streaming. Mm-hmm. Live streaming is a technology which so far is only, you know, limited to strictly, you know, defense applications.
Okay.
You know, we are still, it will only take once the non-governmental private sector consortia will start launching their own satellites, and that's already under works. You know, there are micro satellites. There is this concept of micro satellites, which is being developed both in the Silicon Valley, in the U.S. There are some European approaches to that. Actually, in Russia, there are also some venture, you know, IT venture companies associated with Skolkovo. That are also involved in this microsat development. So once they start launching those, you know, like one cubic foot of payload, they will start being able to target those cameras to as they need. Because right now, what is called shutter control is still with defense applications.
It sounds very positive, though, actually, that it isn't just like video streaming, which will allay probably a lot of people's fears that it's going to be used for the wrong kind of surveillance. So it sounds quite positive. So who do you think we're talking about then? You know, like you mentioned, are we talking about people who are concerned about the environment, maybe perhaps watching over certain endangered animals? I mean, what, forestry's commissions worried about forest fires?
Yes, forest fires. Yes, there is a lot that you can do with this kind of imagery, which does not require real time, like, you know, chasing the bad guy type thing. But still, there is a lot of illegal encroachment on certain areas where agricultural fields, you know, grow, or some infrastructure is being built illegally into protected areas or into forests. And it's possible to capture that and actually convey it to the legal
process. And I guess that's part of the problem, because Russia is such a vast country, it's very hard to keep an eye on such large amounts of land, and this would be one way of intermittently doing so.
And that's exactly what they picked up. I mean, we jointly kind of worked on this concept, developed a slogan of adopt a pixel, which means like the what is called crowdsourcing, you know, crowd mapping, you know, essentially any sixth grader, you know, from middle school, you know, having subscribed to this access, can use his or her iPad, you know, to watch what's happening.
Keep an eye on that.
And keep an eye on that particular part of the forest.
You keep repeating that it's keeping an eye on things, but this imagery, how often does it update?
Well, that's again where things need to change.
Yeah.
Right now, most of those satellite companies that provide this data on a commercial basis, they have a retention policy of 6 months, whether it's for...
So in 6 months, so much can change. You
correct.
Click on your...
There's already a lot of examples with Scanex and other companies where they can actually target acquisitions of imagery for faster developing situations. Mm-hmm. They were giving us some wonderful story of how they were working together with the Rosatom flot, you know, this polar icebreaker fleet, to reroute the path of icebreakers so that they can go around the concentrations of seal cubs.
Aww.
You know, those, you know, little babies.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you cut across, then you separate the population
and the kind of...
So there is a lot of those more real-time applications.
But then it's so expensive to rescan everything. How is it going to be funded, or is that still funded through selling data to defense sources?
There are many
because
issues.
Because it sounds very charitable.
Yeah, there are
so
many
far.
Issues with the current currently the market is set up. Of course, the role of the government is very significant in creating a boost in demand for such civilian applications. And here, the volume is really important, because if you just, you know, buying a particular imagery for your particular, you know, plant or your pipeline or whatever commercially,
the cost is
you know, X. If you have you know, 100 square kilometers of coverage, you know, across your areas of interest, and if you say I want to acquire these imagery, you know, every month or every 2 weeks, and you have a depth of your kind of purchase volume, then prices plummet. You know, you can reduce the prices mm-hmm. tenfold or even almost like.
I mean, you talked about the charitable side of all this, but bottom line, you see this as being a viable commercial product in the future.
Well, eventually there are two things. One is that raw data, I guess, above certain scale, shall be made available for free, and mm-hmm. such as, you know, Landsat, NASA, they've already made it a policy that mm-hmm. anything that is acquired through government, these government-funded projects, is available for free to anyone. The value-added products, such as, you know, processing of the data, of course, people can already charge mm-hmm. for it. In with high-resolution data, which is this, you know, very detailed imagery, there is also a way of, if there is sufficient demand for it, and that's what this project is trying to generate that mm-hmm. demand. If you have sufficient demand, then you can, you know, push the prices down so that they become actually affordable. Mm-hmm. So many of those non-commercial projects mm-hmm. That with non-governmental organizations, international organizations, government projects, kind of on non-commercial, kind of more economic and more affordable prices. So that becomes a very feasible proposition
All
to
right,
have such monitoring
we'll keep
projects
an eye on that. Thank
running
you.
And be exciting. Yeah. So we really look forward to the start of this project, which will, I understand, will be announced at the conference. And
so do we now. Thank you for making the time and coming over into the studio. Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you very much.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Okay. Let's